Good morning, Saints. I want to thank Sister D for that wonderful, wonderful remark, song. You know, his eyes are on the sparrow, he watches over me. You know, if he'll watch over a bird or animal, you think he'll do over us? Saints, it's time for the word, my favorite time. You know, you had a hard, long week of work, and you need something to get you through. And the only thing that will carry you through is the word of God. So have you ever wondered why people don't go to church? I know several people that know the word of God better than most preachers, but yet and still, they don't attend church. Their mother is on the mother's board. Their father preached. Their uncles were on the deacon's board. Their siblings sang in the choir. And they taught Sunday school. But yet and still, they don't attend church. And if you ask them, why don't you go to church? They'll give you one of these answers. I don't have no clothes to wear. I have to fix some things in my life. You ask the question, why don't you go to church? I'm just too busy. There are too many hypocrites in the church. You ask the question, why don't you go to church? I did a lot of bad things in the past. The pastors just want your money. Why don't you go to church? I'm just not ready. Well, Saints, you know, we like to use God's words for measurement to make decisions in life and everything. So let's see what the Word of God says about this. If you have your Bible, turn with me to Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verses 21 through 25. If you have a cell phone or any other electronic media, scroll with me to Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verses 21 through 25. If you're scrolling through the Bible, like me, old school, go to the back of the Bible towards Revelation, go about six chapters, read about in front of James, you'll see Hebrews. So Hebrews, 10th chapter, verses 21 through 25, and it reads, and having an high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works, not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more, as ye see the day approaching. You may be seated. I want to use for a subject, why go to church? Why go to church? Saints, this is more of a teaching message than a preaching message, because I want you to get something out of this. When you go home, I want you to better sit down and talk to your family and friends and say, what is a church? Why was the church established? And finally, why go to church? So you know, Paul was instrumental in starting churches. In Ephesians 1, it talks about Paul being in Ephesus. He was talking about spiritual blessings of Christ. He was giving thanksgiving prayer. He was talking about Jesus being raised from the dead and Jesus being sitting at the right hand side of God. So I'm paraphrasing from Ephesians 1 verses 21 through 23. He's talking about Jesus. He has all principality and powers and might and dominion, and his name is above every name. and put all things under his feet, and gave him to be the head over all things in the church, which is the body. So Jesus is the head and the body of the church. So saints, for the next few minutes, I want to discuss 3 points. Point number one, what is the church? Point number two, the purpose of the church. And point number three, why go to church? If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Matthew, the 16th chapter, verse 18. Matthew, the 16th chapter, verse 18. And it reads, "And I say also unto thee, that thou art Peter, upon this rock I build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." The gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So will the world come against the church? No. Can Satan come against the church? No. Can COVID-19 come against the church? No. Just this past week, I was reading an article. The title was, "Millions Skip Church During Pandemic. Will They Return?" I also read several other articles to get a good understanding about people not going to church. And out of a synopsis of what I read was 57% of the people that went to church, they stopped going, but they still go to church online or watch television. I read another article by the Pew Research Center that said 25% of all the people surveyed that said even though the pandemic was rough, they became closer to God because of the pandemic. So faith grew because of the pandemic. Matthew 16 and 18 says, "Upon this rock I build my church." Some of you smart people are probably saying, Jesus didn't say church. Yeah, maybe he didn't. I think Jesus spoke Aramaic or some form of Greek. But if Jesus could raise Lazarus from the dead, if he could bring himself back from the dead, he could speak any language he wants to speak. But to your point, Jesus spoke Aramaic. And the church was called Ecclesia back then. So let me break Ecclesia down. The Greek Ecclesia, the first part, preposition meaning out of, kaleo signifying to call. So literally it means to call out of. So this word Ecclesia originated back in Athens, Greece, about 580 BC. And the government back then was autocratic. In other words, you had one ruler or a select people who actually ruled the country. And the way they passed it on was by the bloodline. But they had these tyrants, which were people trying to usurp the authority of the kings and the people rulers. And they didn't like the way that things was going, so they met with a large number of people. And they voted on things, become like more democratic like it is today. So I read somewhere that the tyrants took about 6,000 people to pass legislature or pass a law. So this is a more democratic. So the church was pretty much an assembly of people ruled by God through men. I'm going on to Acts, the 8th chapter, around about verse 3. It says, "And Saul, he made havoc on the church, entering every house and dragging out men and women, committing them to prison." So Saul wrought havoc upon the church. He started taking people off, men, women, and sending them to prison. The church was in Antioch, and when Paul was persecuted.
Turn that down a little bit.
When Paul was doing this in the church, but at the same time, Stephen was killed. And he was, scattered people traveled to Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch, and they spread the word of Jesus when it was going to Antioch. They spread it to the Jews first, then it spread it to the Greeks, and later Gentiles. So when news reached Jerusalem about all the slaughter and what was going on, so they sent Barnabas to Antioch. So when Barnabas went to Antioch, he reached out. He wanted to get Paul. So Barnabas went to Saul to look, went to Tarsus to look for Saul, and he found him. When he found Saul, he brought him back to Antioch. And they taught at Antioch for around a year. They had large numbers of people they taught. So the disciples of Christ were first called Christians in Acts 11:26. In Deuteronomy, the 4th chapter, verse 10, it says, "Remember the day you stood before the Lord your God at Horeb, when he said to me, 'Assemble the people before me to hear the words, that they may learn to revere me as long as they live in the land, and may teach them their children.'" I brought that up because if you look back in history, before you had the Bible, before you had the scroll, people passed words on through word of mouth. So my point is, church probably assembled way, way back then, but as I mentioned before, the first documented church is probably the New Testament church. My second point is the purpose of the church. The purpose of the church is for teaching. The purpose of the church is for rebuking. The purpose of the church is for correcting. And the purpose of the church is for training. So what the church does is it brings people together from different backgrounds, different talents, and prepares them to do the word of God. It does this both internally and externally. What I mean by internally, it prepares people inside the church for the work outside when they go out and witness to other people. So to make this simple, the church is a training ground. As most of you know, I was in the military for around 35 years. But before I went to the military, I had to go to basic training. And if any soldiers are here, you know, basic training is you ready for what to come. In other words, I didn't know anything about being a soldier. I was a civilian. So I went to basic training and taught me how to get up early in the morning, maybe 4 o'clock in the morning, do push-ups, do sit-ups, get disciplined, taught me how to do the basic military skills, shooting a weapon, land, navigation, talk about transportation, communication. He's talking about things you need to do for the military to get you ready. Then once you get finished with basic training, you go to do something called advanced individual training. We call it AIT. This prepares you for the outside of your job. For example, if you're a mechanic, it teaches you the mechanical skills. If you're a nurse, it teaches you the nurse skills. Or if you're a logistician, or whatever you are, it teaches you that skill. It's the same within the church. It trains you for what you have to do inside the church and outside the church. If we break this down a little bit further, we're talking about teaching and training. So this is pretty much about teaching and breaking bread together. In Acts, the 2nd chapter, in verse 42, it's talking about the apostles teaching, having fellowship, and breaking bread together. And also, they pray. I tell you, someone said, I think it was Father Payton, a Catholic, a family that prays together, stays together. That's an important thing right there. If you don't remember anything else from this message, remember, a family that prays together, stays together. So who trains the people in church? Well, Ephesians, 11th chapter, right around the 11th through the 13th verse, it says, "So Christ gave apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers. He gave them to equip the people God for the service of Christ." So this builds a sound body of Christ, the good training. So breaking bread is no more than sharing a meal together, a fellowshipping with others. In this context, in the Bible, it refers to the unleavened bread and also the vine. For most of you, what comes to mind is when I say this is the Lord's Supper. The Lord's Supper reminds us of Christ's sacrifice for our sins. It reminds us to reconcile our differences. What it does is it forces us to examine ourselves and to right all wrongs. This is the early church. Prayed together. We now should pray. So if we're in church, we should show honor to one another, show encouragement to one another, and love one another. We also need to meet each other's need. Nothing like having a problem and no one to talk to. So if you've got someone in the church that you have someone you can share with it, maybe they've been through it before. Now, how does the church help us externally? What do? Okay, externally, or outside the church, or better yet, in the world, what the church does is fulfill the Great Commission. The Great Commission is found around about Matthew 28 chapter, verses 18 through 20. The Great Commission is nothing more than bringing other people to Christ, introducing people to Christ. If you're a Christian, I'm sure you have people in your family that are not saved. You need to introduce them to Christ. If you're a Christian, you go out talking to different people about different things at your job or conversation. Somehow, sometime, at least every now and then, you should bring Christ up in your conversation. So Matthew 28, verse 18 to 20, I'm paraphrasing again. Go ye, therefore, and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I commanded you. So, externally, what the church is supposed to do, once you receive your training, like military training or church training from the pastors, teachers, evangelists, what you need to do next is to help others. Someone probably thought, how do we help others? We're hurting ourselves. Well, we should be helping the orphans and the widows. But typically we're supposed to help everybody. And this is not me saying this. This is what the Bible says. In Matthew, the 25th chapter, verses 35 through 41. They said, when I was hungry, you gave me something to eat. When I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. When I was a stranger, you invited me in. When I needed clothes, you clothed me. When I was sick, you came to visit me. When I was in prison, you came to visit me. So our job is to help others. So my third and final point is, why go to church? Why go to church? We go to church, saints, to become closer to God. We go to church, saints, to have a better moral foundation for us and the children. We go to church, saints, for in tough times. So when you're having trouble, you need someone to talk to, that's a good reason to go to church. When you get that call that your son was just shot and killed, you need someone to support you. When you get a diagnosis of cancer, you need some support. When you get the phone call that your mother or father just passed away, you need support. Your child gets sentenced to 12 years in prison. You need someone to support you. When your 7-year-old girl, whom you deeply, deeply love, comes to you and says, Mama, my uncle molested me. What do? You need someone to talk to. You need a church family. Or if you're married person, your spouse comes to you and says, honey, I love you, but I found somebody younger. Or if the wife tells her husband, I found a younger man to replace you with. So you need someone to support you. You need someone in church to listen to you. So the bottom line is, you need to have a relationship with God. God never leave you or forsake you. He will bring about peace that surpasses all understanding. He'll help you not to worry, help you not to fear, and help you to accept the things you can't change. In closing, church is really, really important. It should be a part of everyone's life. If nothing more, the reason to go to church is because God says so. In times of need, you need someone to talk to. Church people are there. Someone there has been through something you went through to talk to. Someone to call and check on you from time to time. You're in the hospital and you're sick. Someone say, hey, sister, hey, brother, can I help you? Or you got to go out of town for a month or two to take care of your spouse. Church members come by and say, hey, sister, hey, brother, can I cut your grass? Or when you're sick and down in the bed, someone want to bring some food to you. So it's good to have a church family. It's good to have a relationship with Christ. So, saints, why go to church? You go to church to have a relationship with God, relationship with saints, and to bring others to Christ. I never want to end a sermon by giving you the opportunity to be saved. Being saved is not easy, but it's worth it. To be saved, you need to hear the gospel, you need to believe the gospel in your heart, you need to repent of your evil ways and confess with your mouth. Once you do this, you'll be baptized and start a relationship with God. This means you could start reading your Bible, start going to Bible study, start going to church, start fellowshipping, and just start a relationship with our Savior, your Lord Jesus Christ. So if you want to be saved, repeat after me. Dear God, I'm a sinner. I ask you to forgive me for my sins. I want to trust you and make you and only you ruler of my life. I believe that Jesus died for our sins and rose 3 days later, was raised from the dead. I pray this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Go out and start a relationship with Jesus Christ.